Well, good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you for the kind introduction. And thank you to the Royal Society of New Zealand for inviting me here and sponsoring my visit. It's my first time in New Zealand, and it's been an absolute pleasure to see your extraordinarily beautiful country. My talk tonight is about nature, so it's very relevant to many contemporary issues in New Zealand. And just to introduce the title, it's a deliberately ambiguous title in terms of both how I'm using the word nature and how I'm using the word value. So I'm going to start by talking about nature in a very traditional conservationist sense of rare species and habitats. But as I move through the talk, I'll broaden that out to thinking about nature in a much more broad and inclusive way, thinking about all the things that natural systems do that we depend on. So nature provides us with many benefits and services for free: clean air, clean water, energy, and so on. And I'll dwell a bit on how we think about nature in that broader sense, as well as the slightly more traditional one about rare species and habitats. And value is another of these words that can mean different things. So sometimes when I say I'm talking about valuing nature, people immediately leap to the idea that I'm putting a monetary value on it and entering the whole world of buying and selling environmental services. And I will talk a bit about that, and I'll certainly at the end I'll come into some monetary valuation of nature services that we've used in a policy sense in the UK. But through most of my talk, what I mean by value is how much do we appreciate it? How much do we understand what nature's providing to us for free? And how much do we value it in the sense that we're willing to nurture it, protect it, and even more importantly, to invest in it? So that's a little explanation of the title. I think my talk is probably a rather European bias. So forgive me if some of the things that I talk about don't exactly translate to New Zealand context. But I think many of them will, from what I've seen and heard. I don't think it's an entirely European way of looking at things. So, to start with the thing that I'm sure you're all aware of, when we think about wild species and wild habitats, the diversity of life on Earth, the sort of traditional measure of nature's diversity, the impacts of human beings over hundreds of years, maybe thousands of years, have been to reduce that level of diversity in many different ways, reducing the abundance of wildlife, altering landscapes. But the metric that I've put up here is one about local species richness. So perhaps the most iconic measure of biodiversity, which is how many species are there at a particular location. And this is a plot, it's a hockey stick curve. We're used to seeing hockey stick curves for climate. This is a hockey stick curve for biodiversity. And it's showing estimated trends in the average local species richness across the surface of the Earth from 1500 to the year 2000. And there's obviously some errors about that. So the thing that you can see most markedly is this dip that occurs at about 1850. After 1850, Industrial Revolution, and certainly time of big European colonizations, local species richness suddenly starts to take a big dip. And on average, we've lost 14% of species from any one place on Earth over that period of time. Actually, if you go further back in human history, we've lost even more. But the major changes have been in the last 150 years or so. The little curves at the end, actually, interestingly, are different future scenarios under different models of climate change. And I think the main point here is it's in our hands what happens next. There are things that we can do that may reverse that trend, and there are things that we may do that simply mean that trend continues to decline. Now, if we look at that, that's the average there is 14%, but it varies a lot over the surface of the Earth. So this is a plot of what's happened to local species richness globally, but mapped across the surface of the Earth. So the darker the red, the more that has been lost. In the very darkest areas, there's less than 60% of the original species left remaining. And you can see the areas that are blue, which are more or less intact, are places really where there aren't very many species and there aren't very many people, and there aren't very many things that people are doing there, particularly the dark red areas here is where there's been a lot of agricultural impact, a lot of land use change, and there are some of the big reserve areas like Amazonia and so on are still relatively intact. Now, I have to apologise about this map because New Zealand is a tiny little thing stuck on the corner of the map. I'm sorry about that, so I blew it up. graphically, not literally, because I'm sure you'll be interested to see what this actually looks like for New Zealand. And it's a pretty sad story. This is a model based largely on land use change, which is why it's it is particularly bad in Australia and New Zealand. Now, that loss of diversity is caused by things that we understand really pretty well. We've spent a lot of time over the last few decades documenting the threats to wildlife and to ecosystem change, and we know what they are. We know what the direct threats are: habitat loss, overexploitation, pollution and invasive species, and of course, increasingly now, climate change. And we know what the drivers of those direct threats are. The things that ultimately cause those are things like the size of the human population, the amount of fertilizer we're tipping on the surface of the earth, the number of fisheries that are being caught, the amount of carbon dioxide that's been emitted. And on the right there, you'll see that all these trends are inevitably going to continue, and many of them are going to increase, sometimes at increasing rates. So the picture that we've seen of biodiversity loss is not about to suddenly stop. It would be great if it were, but it would require us to reverse these major drivers of change to do with human population growth and growth in consumption and human activity. And that begs a really complicated question about what should be the goal of conservation. What are we actually expecting to be able to achieve in conservation? What would success look like? And what I want to do now is talk a little bit about what those framings of conservation are, to think about what is conservation for? How would we know when we'd achieved it? And it's a really interesting phenomenon that although conservation is a shared value that many people hold, there are not so many shared values about what it's actually for. Everyone agrees that species extinction is bad, that's definitely the worst thing, we don't want to lose species, and that a lot of landscape change is bad and damaging. But exactly what we're aiming for is less clear. And in the next few slides, I just want to run through four framings of conservation, which are a bit of a sort of personal caricature of the phases of my work in conservation, but you'll see how it takes me into what I want to talk about after that. So the original idea of conservation, going back to the sort of 1960s, and certainly the training I had as an undergraduate, was what I call nature for itself, that the idea of conservation was to preserve nature, mostly in protected areas and national parks, thinking about wilderness pretty much away from people, just being able to put nature in a safe place and let it get on with what it was doing. And so the kind of iconic images of nature for itself, or this framing of conservation, is a sort of beautiful species, beautiful places, remote wilderness areas. And none of this really has any people in it. It's kind of away from people. It's implicitly it's for people, but it definitely is not about people. And what I learned was how to design protected areas, whether you should have one large one or lots of small ones, whether they should be fenced or unfenced, how you should move species in and out of them and so on. And so it was very much about keeping nature in its own area while we got on with doing whatever it is that people were doing. Now, this is still a very common way of thinking about conservation, but by about the middle of the 1980s, it became clear this was not going to work as a general framing for conservation. Protected areas were not enough because of these major pressures driving species numbers downwards. And we move into the phase that I call nature despite people. So this is about understanding the pressures on species. It's about trying to hold back those forces of decline. So we start to see a lot of investigation of extinctions, and particularly trying to understand those drivers, habitat loss, invasive species, disease, pollution, all the threats to species, and a lot of work to act on mitigating them locally and sometimes regionally in order to hold back that pressure. So now the iconic images become these sort of devastated landscapes of deforestation, the over-harvesting of megafauna in Africa, and sort of ghastly images of hunting bushmeat and so on. And so the idea here was, let's just deal with the threats and that will be enough. Well, that didn't work either. By the end of the last century, by the end of the 1990s or so, all the trends in biodiversity were still heading downwards, and many of them at increasing rates. And then we see this flip around in conservation thinking, which is to say, what does nature do for people? And the third framing here, the one I call nature for people, is about ecosystem services. So now we're starting to say, if we lose nature, if we lose all these species and habitats, how will people be deprived of something that's important or significant to them? So now it's no longer about species, it's much more about ecosystems, and there's a lot more thinking about services and benefits. And we see the valuation and economic terms starting to creep into thinking about nature. Now, this ecosystem services framing, I worked on this a lot doing the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment, and we did think quite hard about what it meant, but it always was about what nature does for people. It was a rather selfish view of let's save nature because it's good for us. And we see these images now of human-dominated landscapes. There are definitely people in ecosystems, but it's all quite utilitarian. It's and dominated a lot by water. Water is a very easy ecosystem service to measure. Some of the more species-orientated ones are much more difficult. The obvious poster child of ecosystem services are pollinators, and there's been a huge amount of work done on pollinators to look at how preserving biodiversity preserves pollinators. And the ecosystem services framing was quite successful, but it has a couple of problems. One is it's ridiculously complicated to try and implement in any real sense. And I've tried to do this, and I've drawn absurdly overcomplicated diagrams like this. I didn't actually draw this one. But it is a very complex idea, and policy and legislation really struggle with it, and the terminology is quite awkward as well. I also find it awkward because I think it's overly utilitarian, this idea that we're only interested in nature for what it provides for us. And so we move into this fourth one, the fourth framing that I call people and nature, which is a slightly nuanced version of perhaps the other three in some way put together. But this is very different in the way that people talk about it. So now it actually is about species and ecosystems. But the dominant ideas are about resilience. It's based around environmental change. It's based around the idea that we don't live in a stable, predictable environment, and that we and the nature that we depend on are going to have to cope with a lot of changes that are taking place very fast. It also brings in a lot more of the social science, trying to understand people's interactions with nature. But the way I'd characterize the people and nature framing is that it recognizes that people and nature are locked into some dynamic interaction. We have evolved over the course of hundreds of thousands of years with nature and nature's systems. We've come to rely on it. But equally, we interact with it on a daily basis, and we rely on nature, nature relies on us. And one of the nice things about this dynamic interaction between people and nature is that we can provide systems to nature to help nature support people in a changing world. So now we see images of human-dominated landscapes, but they're kind of nice. They look more attractive. We're These are some sand dunes that are engineered to help the grass get in bed better. So this is people helping nature to help nature help people. And we see far more people in nature doing it and enjoying it in various rational and irrational ways. I mean, the way I'd like to characterise that shift that I've described is from preserving these components of species and the patterns of nature that existed maybe a couple of hundred years ago, and towards thinking about future form and function, adaptability and resilience. And perhaps more explicitly for people, although I think conservation has always been implicitly for people. Now, I've presented those four framings as if they happened one after the other, and for me, they certainly did. But for many people, they all still exist. And in fact, they are still all very prominent in different sectors of society. Many conservationists still adhere very strongly to a nature for itself framing. We all work on mitigating threats to species, the nature despite people. Ecosystem services is a strong and vibrant field of development in environmental science, and people and nature is kind of the new kid on the block. So what happens is that by the time we get down to the present day, down here in 2015 or whatever, wherever we are now, all four of those ideologies are sitting there alongside each other, and it causes confusion about this: what is the objective of conservation? Because if you think about it, the answer to the question of why does biodiversity loss matter depends on which of those framings you're centred on. If you're thinking about nature for itself, then extinction rates is a perfectly good measure. But if you're thinking about ecosystem services, it probably isn't. Measuring conservation success. How do we know when we've been successful? Keeping all the endangered species from going extinct might be a good goal and the nature for itself, but those rare and threatened species sparsely distributed across the landscape do almost nothing for ecosystem services or directly for people. And the same is true about designing management. So I think it would be good if over the next few decades we can move into a more coherent framing of what conservation is for. And I like to think that the nature and people and nature framing is one that embraces many of these others and that would give us a way of thinking more creatively about how to cope with the relentless pressures on biodiversity. Now, what I'm going to do in the rest of this talk is rather briefly present two pieces of work that I've been involved in over the last few years that are thinking about this linked humans to nature system. And they're bits of science policy, really. They're both strongly policy linked rather than being pure science. And I thought that might be interesting, particularly here, because of the linkages between the work that scientists do and government does in terms of policy. So the first one I'm going to present is a project that I did with the Royal Society in London, looking at resilience to extreme weather and particularly the role that ecosystems might play in that. And the second one is a project that I'm involved in at the moment, working with the UK government as a member of the Natural Capital Committee, thinking about natural capital accounting. So let me start with the first one. So this was a project on resilience to extreme weather that we undertook in 2014-2015, actually in the run-up to the big climate change meeting in Paris. And the idea here is that climate change is definitely happening. It's a major problem, but the main way in which it will be felt by people will be through extreme weather. So there are many indirect effects of climate change on, say, crop production or disease outbreaks and so on. But many people will face it immediately because of changes to weather patterns, more extreme rainfall, droughts, patterns of very unusual weather, which is predicted to accompany climate change. And we wanted to look at how governments, particularly how national governments might develop resilience to extreme weather. And of course, this is not something in the future. It's something that society is already facing. The picture here at the bottom is Superstorm Sandy that later went on to hit New York. This is it it's in the Caribbean somewhere, sorry, I can't remember where it is. But it's that we've seen many of these storms flipping through and devastating communities, including what happened in New York, New Orleans, and so on. So we looked at extreme weather that would cause coastal flooding, river flooding, droughts, and heat waves. We looked at how those impacts might change in the future using some climate modelling, and then we looked at how best to build resilience, including with ecosystem-based solutions. And the group that did this was sort of interdisciplinary group of some climate scientists, some economists, some political scientists, some political economists, and geographers, hydrologists, a broad range of people to try and pull together the evidence. So the problem of extreme weather is not just about the extreme weather. That's going to get worse under climate change. But the impacts on people are also going to be escalating because there'll be more people, and also because more people are living in areas where they're particularly vulnerable to extreme weather, for example, on coasts, in estuaries and so on. And so we did a bit of modelling with the climate people to look at where these future impacts might be greatest. So I'll just take you through one of the models that we did just to show you that how we approached estimating the future impacts. So this is the one for heat waves. So the first thing that happened was you run a climate model every year for 100 years and look at the frequency with which you get periods of very extreme hot weather, 5 days in a row that lie outside the 95% confidence intervals for weather in that region. And this just shows you how that extreme heat, long periods of very hot weather, will change over the next 100 years. So it's the ratio of the frequency of that in 2090 compared with 1990. And you can see in the dark red areas it goes up to about 3 times as frequent. And unsurprisingly, heat waves are more common on land than they are in the sea. They're more common where people live and where the oceans don't mitigate the heat. So then we looked at the exposure of people to those heat waves. So this is where people live in 2010, the highest densities in red areas. But of course, that's going to change. And so we look at where people are going to live in 2090. This is from a UN population projection. And now we can look at the frequency of impacts of heat waves on people as a result of climate change over the next 100 years. So you can see that increasing goes up to about 1.5 times the number. And then but from climate and population change. So the population changes are really important, partly because population growth is very high in these areas where there's expected to be increased frequency of heat waves. So here's the three that we looked at, heat waves, floods, and droughts, and the multiples, so climate, the contribution from climate change and population I've just shown you for heat waves. So 3 times for climate, 4 times for population, a total of 12 times the number of impacts. And then these are the flood and drought ones, which are actually slightly less than the heat wave one. So there is going to be this problem of increasing frequencies of extreme weather. So the question is, how do we mitigate that? What should be done about it? And we looked at 3 kinds of defences that are traditionally used. They could be engineered defences. This is the Thames Barrier, the classic engineered defence. Dams, barrages, air conditioning systems are all those kind of engineered solutions. We looked at ecosystem-based or nature-based solutions, floodplains, salt marshes, and we looked at these hybrids where there's a bit of engineering that goes in to help nature in various ways. This is actually taken in an area outside New York of people putting in engineered structures to reinforce the dune system around the northern shores of New York. So what we did was, in a semi-quantitative way, the evidence turned out to be rather difficult to organise, but we put together these scores of how effective different kinds of interventions were. So let me just explain this graph. The y-axis, the vertical axis, is the effectiveness of the intervention, how well it works. The ones at the top are the most effective, they work well. The horizontal axis, the x-axis, is the cost, and the ones on the right are cheaper, ones on the left are more expensive. So your ideal intervention sits in the top right-hand corner, up here somewhere, where there isn't anything. It's cheap and efficient. And as with most things, you pay more, you get a better system. So these are the engineered ones. The grey blobs are engineered, the orange ones are hybrid, and the green ones are ecosystem-based. So although that is a negative slope, there isn't anything in the top right-hand corner, some of these ecosystem-based solutions do actually work pretty well. So the second one there is mangroves. This is coastal flooding. So mangroves do a fairly good job of coastal flooding, and they're very cheap. Number four is maintenance of salt marshes, wetlands, and intertidal ecosystems. That also does pretty well. And number eight, which is a sort of engineered one, is about beach and dune nourishment. So this is about supporting the growth of beaches and dunes. So here's a similar one for river flooding. Again, the most effective thing to do is to build dams, that's number eight, or to build drains and dikes. But again, some of the ecosystem-based things, particularly floodplains, and afforestation of catchments and things like that, do a pretty good job as well. And you can see in this one, they're definitely up there competing with the effectiveness of some of the engineered solutions. So this is a not very scientific slide, but it tries to summarise what we found across these different extreme weather events, that the engineered things tended to be, on the whole, effective, but were quite expensive. The ecosystem ones could be pretty good, but were cheap. But there's quite a lot of these ones in between where people are supporting nature and natural solutions and are fairly good. Now, one of the other interesting things here is that the engineered solutions, although they work very well, when they fail catastrophically. So when a dam breaks or when a dike is overwhelmed, it's devastating. And it happens very quickly. And unlike the ecosystem-based ones, they are the responsibility of some other body. They're not the responsibility of the community that gets devastated by them. On the other hand, these ecosystem-based ones, when they fail quite slowly. And the management of them can be adaptive to the increased pressures. So there's a sort of slightly subtle thing in a changing world. It may be easier to cope with unprecedented changes with ecosystem or hybrid interventions than it is with fully engineered ones, partly because they fail more slowly and partly because people will inevitably take more interest in them. And one of the reasons that people take more interest in them is that the ecosystem-based or nature-based solutions have other benefits as well. They have some co-benefits. So here we tried to look at the relative co-benefits of ecosystem-based ones in green, engineered ones in grey, and hybrid ones in orange, in terms of access to food, livelihoods, climate change mitigation, access to water, biodiversity conservation, and protection against multiple hazards. So you can see that the hybrid and the ecosystem-based solutions have many more co-benefits. And for that reason as well, they may be preferred. So our conclusion from this study was that these strategies to provide defence and resilience to extreme weather, people should look at a broader portfolio of measures, not just the traditional engineering things. And in particular, that some of these nature-based solutions may be quite cheap, relatively sustainable, and provide many co-benefits. But perhaps most striking of all, the evidence here was really weak. That we could not, what I've shown you is not a terribly strong analysis. It was a semi-quantitative expert-based assessment. And it would be really good to gather this data and start collecting stronger evidence about what works where. If you want to look at more of this, it's there's loads of material on the Royal Society's website, and if you just Google it, resilience to extreme weather and Royal Society, I think if you just Google it, resilience to extreme weather, it comes up, and lots of the data that I showed you there is available. Okay, now the second example, I'm moving now back into the UK and into national government policy. And I'm going to talk about this work that I've been doing with the Natural Capital Committee. Now, the origins of this come from the UK government's Natural Environment White Paper, which came out in 2011. This was a white paper produced by the coalition government that came into power in 2010. And they made this commitment in the white paper to be the first generation to leave the natural environment in a better state than it inherited. There's something grammatically wrong with that, I know, but it's in the white paper, so I didn't like to rewrite it. But you can see what a bold and interesting goal that is to set up for the natural environment. So in a generation, 25 years or so, we're going to leave the natural environment in a better state than it's in now for future generations. And this, the goal and the many of the commitments in the 2011 white paper have been recommitted to by our current government, the Conservative government that was elected in 2015. And actually all the political parties, the big political parties that ran in the election in 2015 reiterated something to do with that goal, not the exact same words, but something similar. So that white paper created a Natural Capital Committee. And the Natural Capital Committee was to be an independent body to report to the government's Economic Affairs Committee, chaired by the Chancellor, so taking it pretty seriously. And this body will put the value of nature at the heart of government's economic thinking and advise government about the best way of securing our natural assets for the future. So I've been a member of this committee since 2012. The first committee was wound up in 2015, and a new one was created last year, which I'm also a member of. And I'm going to talk to you about some of the work that we've done to try and address that plan, the 25-year goal, but also thinking about how to achieve what's here to put the value of nature at the heart of government's economic thinking. I'm not going to try and convince you that we've succeeded in that, but I'll show you how we're going about it. So the first thing is just to think about that goal for a minute. It is an extremely ambitious idea. So this is a bit of a cartoon, but imagine here's the course of time and here's 2015, and here's nature or natural capital or whatever we want to call it, and it's kind of declining, as we've seen. We know that's the case, and in the UK we have a State of Nature report that shows that repeatedly. Now what that goal says is that in 25 years' time, the state of nature has got to be better than it was in 2015. So what that means is it needs to go up this green line here. It needs to actually improve. If business as usual would be it continues to deteriorate down here, down the bottom red line, what we mostly do in conservation action is to try to stop that red line declining so fast. So usually we're just trying to do this, reduce the rate of loss. We might be trying to hold it at bay, protect it to what it was in 2015. But the goal is actually to improve it. That means you've got to not only protect what's there, but invest and improve it in order to enhance nature for 2040. So that is an ambitious thing to do, and I don't think we're making huge progress with it, but we're working on it. Now, the reason this is framed as natural capital is because it needs to be at the heart of government's economic thinking, and that means we have to adopt this whole language around capitals and around natural capital. And I just want to reiterate that this is not about money at this stage. What we're talking about here is the natural assets that underpin all human activity. I like to use this very 1970s coloured blob. So the blue bit here is manufactured and financial capital. That's what you normally think about as capital. And what governments report on GDP is effectively the return on investment in that blue area. But that relies on the pink bit, which is social and human capital, all the things that people do, all of you in this room are human capital, you have knowledge and expertise, and we don't really account for that or report on that at all. And all of that ultimately depends on natural capital, this elements of nature that fundamentally underpin it, the clean air, clean water, genetic resources, energy, and so on. And so natural capital is not about money, it's about investing in that asset or that set of assets that secure all the benefits that society requires. So we think about it in these rather simple terms as a set of natural capital assets, which you might call nature, could be ecosystems, it can be anything that's using natural systems and processes. And we manage that to produce a set of services and goods that fundamentally underpin the benefits and values that society requires and needs. And of course, to get over the right-hand side here, you need the other capital inputs. You need the produced financial capital, and you need the human capital. But well, we're interested in this bit over here, in the natural capital. So what are those assets and what are the benefits? Well, I don't think there's a single right answer to that. We've just come up with a list that we tend to use, which is lots of overlapping natural capital assets, such as species, ecological communities, soils, freshwater, land, the atmosphere, subsoil assets, the oceans, and all the natural processes and functions. But you could divide these up in any way, and in the example I'll show you in a minute, we use habitat types. The benefits, I think, are really interesting to think about, because it turns out to be much easier to think about the benefits and work backwards to what nature does to underpin those than to try and work out all the things that nature does. So starting at the right-hand side and working backwards has proved to be easier than starting at the left-hand side and working forwards. So these benefits that depend to a very large degree on natural assets are things like food, fibre, energy, clean water, clean air, recreation, aesthetics, hazard protection, wildlife and conservation, an equable climate, minerals. You could think of more of them. Now, one thing I want to point out here is that I've got species on both sides here. Species are both an underpinning natural asset. We rely on what species and ecological communities do for many of the things on the right-hand side. Food, for example, needs crop species, and it needs microbial communities in the soil. Fresh water needs microbial communities in freshwater ecosystems and so on. But on the right-hand side, the wildlife and conservation there is the sort of species that are important to people, the iconic conservation species, which are a benefit in their own right. We should be worried about them, not just because they provide services to us, but because we value them. So the first thing that we did, in order to think about securing the benefits that might be at risk, was to develop a risk register for natural capital. And so we define the natural capital assets as being at risk when the benefits that society derives from them can no longer be secured. And that's usually something to do with the condition or the amount or the distribution of the natural asset. And this sounds like it's really ambitious and complicated, but actually it turned out to be much easier than it seems when you break it down into some manageable chunks. So, for example, we can look at the quality of blanket bogs. This is an upland ecosystem type that's very effective at cleaning up fresh water. So if the condition of the blanket bog is good, then there's a very high value for clean water. The avoided cost of cleaning up water can be quite substantial. But there's a very steep threshold. As the condition of the bog declines, it just reaches a point where it effectively isn't doing it at all, and then goes to a point where there's almost no clean-up being provided. And we know something about where that break point is. We can look at the value of planting of woodlands, new woodlands, for things like recreational value or for wildlife conservation. And we can look at the kind of relationship, this functional relationship for that as well. So this is the extent of woodland planting and the value for recreation or the value for wildlife conservation. These have a slightly different shape curved. For recreation, particularly for woodlands that are near where people live, you need a certain sort of area, and the value goes up as the area increases. But once you've got enough, people don't need any more of it. They can only walk around a certain area of woodland. So you can characterise these curves for these different benefit-asset relationships. And we were very lucky when we did this, because in 2011, we'd published the UK National Ecosystem Assessment and gathered a lot of this data according to these broad habitat types in the UK. So the analysis that we did rested on that big project and was centred around these major habitat types. So I won't go through this in detail because it would be impossible for you to read, but this is a summary of our risk register. So it shows for all these major habitat types, mountains, enclosed farmlands, semi-natural grasslands, woodlands, freshwaters, urban, coast, and marine. For each of those, we looked at the quantity, the quality, and the spatial configuration. So the quality is kind of the management of it, or how effectively it's managed. For each of these sorts of benefits, food, fibre, energy, clean water, clean air, recreation, aesthetics, hazard, wildlife, and equable climate. And the red blobs are where the condition of the asset looked like it was already below a required level or was heading down there very fast. And the green blobs is kind of where it looks okay. And there's lots of grey because there are things we don't know and things that don't matter. So from that analysis, we could come up with a set of recommendations to government about the benefits from natural capital that were at risk or very high risk. So, and for each of those, we were quite explicit about what needed to be done, what investments needed to be done to secure that benefit from natural capital. So the benefit at risk, say here, clean water, was mainly about upland areas and about water management in urban areas. For wildlife, a lot of it was about semi-natural grasslands and agricultural practices, but also about fragmentation of natural habitat. So for each of these benefits, we could go through natural assets that needed investment and come up with some specific recommendations to government about what should be done in order that we achieve that 25-year goal. Now, actually, the way government works is not kind of as vague as this. They wanted some real projects. So they wanted some plausible projects of ecosystem restoration or development or even a novel creation of ecosystems that would meet these objectives. And so we also looked at a set of projects that could achieve this kind of goal. And here we started to bring in some of the economic valuations so that we could look at costs, the costs of doing that intervention, and the benefits, using the kind of methodology that government traditionally does for large project evaluations. So looking at cost-benefit evaluations. And these are the ones that where we felt there was good evidence that the return on investment would be positive for public funding. That is where they were going to show a greater long-term value than it would cost to deliver the project. So woodland planting, 250,000 additional hectares near towns and cities, could generate benefits in excess of £500 million a year. And these are using Treasury rules for the valuation. Upland peatland restoration, we've around 140,000 hectares. Wetland creation, protecting and expanding areas of intertidal habitats and improving fisheries management. For all of those, there was really good evidence that they would show positive benefit-cost ratio. There was also a set of really interesting ones where we just couldn't quite get the evidence together, but they looked very promising. So things to do with urban green space, big recreational values, but particularly when they start showing strong health benefits, the benefit-cost ratio can become very high. But the evidence here is not that great. Improving air quality is a very significant issue in the UK at the moment. There's no question there are huge costs from low air quality. It's more difficult to know what the interventions are that actually deal with it. That's why it's on this list. Improving the environmental performance of farming, the more wildlife-friendly farming can definitely show good benefit-cost ratios. But again, the whole structure of subsidies makes that very difficult. And then managing catchments, sort of interesting idea that if you do catchment-based management, you can get many of these co-benefits all at the same time. So what we did then was to look at those benefit-cost ratios for big project investments in natural capital compared to more traditional kinds of government investments in built infrastructure. So here on the left is the benefit-cost ratio, going from sort of 2-1 up to about 20-1. And here are government's own benefit-cost ratios for traditional sorts of built infrastructure, road schemes, light and heavy railway schemes, active travel, flood defences, broadband, housing and non-housing. And you can see it's quite a variation. Rail schemes actually have quite a low benefit-cost ratio, sort of 2-3-1. Broadband is the big one. It goes up to about 20-1. But here are these same estimations for natural capital investments. And you can see they stack up pretty well compared to the built ones. The woodland planting one in particular can get up to about 8-1, so it's well up there with built infrastructure investments. And the same with the inland wetland restoration. So our argument here is that investing in natural capital, investing in ecosystems, can be just as good a return on investment for public funding as built infrastructure can. And one of the recommendations we made in our last report from the last committee was that natural capital assets should be included in the national infrastructure planning process. That hasn't actually happened, but we think the argument is strong. So just to conclude some of the things I've talked about, nature provides many kinds of benefits for people, and we've tended to take them for granted. We just assume that they're going to be there, and that without us really tending or nurturing nature, it will continue to do all those things for us in the future. And I think because of the big pressures that people and their activities are putting on the environment, that can't be assured. And even if it were, we should be taking care of those things that nature does for us. But more particularly now, we should be investing in it because of these new threats that are emerging. So nature conservation and restoration is not a luxury. It's not something you do when you've done all the important things. It's an important activity that needs to be taken particularly seriously in such a rapidly changing world. And these directed and major investments in natural systems can provide resilience for people, they will provide big benefits for people and society, and I think we can show by that kind of analysis that I did at the end that they make economic sense as well. I'm going to finish with a quote from Theodore Roosevelt, who, it turns out, a very long time ago said exactly what I've just said, but he didn't do any of that analysis beforehand. But I really like this. I found it on the wall of the American Museum in New York, American Museum of Natural History in New York. So it starts off, "There is a delight in the hardy life of the open. There are no words that can tell the hidden spirit of the wilderness, that can reveal its mystery, its melancholy, and its charm." That's really nice. But then he says, "The nation behaves well if it treats the natural resources as assets, which it must turn over to the next generation, increased and not impaired in value. Conservation means development as much as it does protection." Thank you very much.